मान्यवर संस्कृति विभाग के राज्य मंत्री डॉक्टर महेश शर्मा जी, आमतौर पर उनको संस्कृति राज्य मंत्री कहते हैं, संस्कृति को एक राज्य बना देते हम। डॉक्टर राजीव कुमार जी, सचिन जी, अतुल जी, ऑल दी इमिनेंट पार्टिसिपेंट्स इन दिस टुडे सेमिनार on the SDGs, trying to connect them with a much bigger and much wider concept of integral humanism. In fact, I appreciate the point made by Dr. Rajiv Kumar that integral humanism is a much wider concept. It's not just limited to SDGs. It includes SDGs, but much more than that. And all the other friends present in the audience. मित्रों, थ्रू द डे टू डे वी आर गोइंग टू एक्सप्लोर द वेरियस डायमेंशंस ऑफ दिस ग्रेट कॉन्सेप्ट कॉल्ड इंटीग्रल ह्यूमनिज्म। माय जॉब इज लिमिटेड टू मेकिंग अ फ्यू इनिशियल कमेंट्स बाय वे ऑफ द सो कॉल्ड कीनोट एड्रेस, सो आई शैल नॉट ट्राई to get into the too much of the details of what integral humanism is all about. I have gone through the schedule today for the sessions, and it is going to cover all the important aspects of integral humanism in different sessions. Let me begin by saying that when we decided to have something called Millennial Development Goals in year 2000 for a period of about 15 years, that is itself showed something very important about the previous century. The 20th century was actually a laboratory of ideas. Aap ek bar us century ka 100 year span dekhenge, you have seen totalitarian regimes, you have seen dictators, you have seen monarchs, you have seen the rise of democracies, you have seen the rise of capitalist ideas, you have seen the rise and demise of communist ideologies, socialism in action was witnessed in the 20th century. 20th century in a way had become a laboratory of ideas for the mankind. We have experimented with all the different kinds of ideas that were available, that were the products of the genius of man. But at the end of it, we decided that with all these ideas in place, all of them being experimented, at the end of the day, we decided that the basic things are not being addressed. What are MDGs? MDGs were so basic for human life that you are talking about free from hunger, free from malaria. These are basic things. Man should be happy, man should be healthy, man should have his full stomach. Something was wrong with all those ideas that were experimented in the 20th century, friends. That is one important lesson that we all have to draw from the experiments of the 20th century, that although they were all important experiments, they were championed by big people, eminent people, something was missing in them. That something was missing in all those ideas was eminently highlighted by two important persons in the last century. One of them was a French Catholic philosopher, Jacques Maritain. In fact, Jacques was the first person to talk against the existing models, whether it was a totalitarian dictatorship or the communist regimes or the socialist models, by saying that in this, man as an integral entity is missing. either man is seen as a political entity, give him a vote, what we call as democracy. Man is a political animal. Or like how the socialist and communist idea, basically communist idea, which has, slightly diversified into socialism, that man is nobody. It is the state, which is everything, which is all important. In both the ideas, the integral entity of man has not been acknowledged, has not been recognized, is what Jaki first identified and highlighted sometime in 30s. Now, in fact, I would say his theory of integral humanism was 30 years older than Deendayalji's integral humanism. He wrote about it in 1936. He also took the contemporary socio-political reality into account while propounding his theory of integral man. Incidentally, after about 3 decades, after India became independent in 1947, almost 15-20 years after India's independence, Deendayal Upadhyay also had highlighted the same thing, stating that all the existing models in the world, they are very compartmentalized. They are addressing only one part of the problem. They are not looking at the whole. We need to look at the whole as one. In that whole, man is at the epicenter. But the thinking has to be integrated. It cannot be in compartments. Man is separate. Society is separate. Nature is separate. World is separate. Universe is separate. That compartmentalized thinking doesn't really help, because that's not the basic nature of this creation. When you try to separate them and compartmentalize them and try to address each thing separately, you will not go anywhere. Finally, you give a man a vote, thinking that he's a political animal. Take the vote and be happy. But after some time, he will come back and say, no, I'm not happy. I have a vote, but I don't have food. Then you will say, all right, vote is not important for you, na? Food is important. I will give you food. I will give you a job. But forget, take the food that I provide, take the job that I give you, and settle down. Then after some time, he will say, no, 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 I need some freedom to speak. So man needs to be looked at from an integral perspective, is what Deendayalji had proposed in 60s through integral humanism. Jaki Maritain made democracy and Jesus and Christ as the basis of his ideology of integral humanism. We said, give democracy as a political thought, but give religion, Jesus, religion as a social thought to man, so that you will be addressing all the aspects of a human being. In fact, Jaki's efforts had led to the creation of social democratic movements in the world. The social democratic parties that you find in some of the European countries are all the products of Jaki's theory of integral humanism. What Deendayalji did was, he did not talk about democracy or Christ, in the sense the God, the religion, separately. He made dharma, which encompasses these two things, but many more things, as the axis of his integral humanist theory. For him, a concept that has dharma as the axis is what needs to be the future of the mankind. Now, when we talk about MDGs or SDGs, these are basically again addressing two aspects of the mankind, two dimensions of it. One is the material needs of a man. Man is a material being also. Capitalist ideology thought that man is materialist being only. You fulfill his material needs, that is the end of it. We in India have not believed that man is material being only. But we must remember, man is material being also. In fact, Sachinji also said that, you know, MDGs and SDGs address so many basic needs of the man in order for the man to lead a happy life. I was at a conference in China some time ago. One Chinese scholar made a very interesting comment. He said, "You Indians can never catch up with us." I asked him, "Why? Why do you think so?" He said, "Look, you are worshippers of poverty. आपके लिए वो एक क्या बोलते उसको कच्चा पहनकर घूमने वाला तो आपको संत महात्मा उनके सामने आप तो प्रोस्टेट कर देते हो आपके लिए वो आइडियल है इज इट ट्रू आर वी रियली वर्शिपर्स ऑफ पॉवर्टी नो डाउट वी आर वर्शिपर्स ऑफ सैक्रिफाइस वी रिवियर वी वर्शिप पीपल हु गिव अप But that doesn't mean we are practitioners of poverty. Indian philosophy is as much about material happiness as any other most materialist philosophy, whether it's communism or capitalism in the world. What is our daily prayer? Sarvepi sukhinas santu. Sarvepi sukhinas santu. Let everybody be happy. What is this happiness? Is it otherworldly happiness? Sarve santu niramayaha. Let everybody be free of any diseases. No disease should be there. It's not about otherworldliness. It's about this world. I should not have any disease. Sarve bhadrani pasyantu. Bhadrani pasyantu is that everybody should enjoy goods in life. You should have a fridge at home. You should have a car at home. You should have a sofa. You should have a bed to sleep. An air-conditioned room. Ma kaschid dukkha bhag bhavet. Nobody should have any sorrows in life. The most materialist prayer. But remember, the operational word in this is sarvepi. This has to be available to everybody. That has been our prayer. We are worshippers of happiness, but happiness to all. Not happiness to a select few. To only those who are capable of enjoying it, capable of achieving it. The Western philosophies, whether it is capitalism or communism, believed that, you know, if you are capable, you will, you know, achieve all those things. You will become rich. But we said no. In fact, Deendayal ji ka famous hai. Ki those who earn shall eat. Nay, those who are born, they shall have a right to eat. Everybody who is born should have a right to eat. That is called sarve sukhinas santu. But in order for everybody to have something to eat, everybody else has to contribute something. Isliye Deendayal ji kaha karte the, jo paida hota hai, wo khayega. Jo kamayega, वो खिलाएगा वन हु एंड्स विल फीड तो हमने तो इस प्रकार के जीवन का एक विचार किया है नाउ द सेंट्रल क्वेश्चन दैट आई वांट टू रेज हियर इज नोबडी विल हैव एनी डिस्प्यूट अबाउट एमडीजीज और एसडीजीज एज आई सेड दीज आर थिंग्स दैट एन ऑर्डिनरी मैन शुड हैव देयर इज पीरियड नो क्वेश्चन But why are they not there? We in India have had an excellent opportunity to address this issue when we became independent in 1947. We could have thought about it. Okay, Deendayal ji was not there to warn us in 1947. He was there, but he was not in a position to warn the country at that time. Jacques was propagating his theory in Europe. But we had our own people like Gandhiji who were cautioning us. Look, don't go that European path. You will suffer. And Gandhiji used to say, Europe will suffer. And today these MDGs and SDGs are because the world is suffering. And even on MDGs, remember, 15 years of MDGs, UN officials are sitting here, they know it very well. We have not achieved 100% success in them. There are still areas where we have to still work. But you know where those areas are? They are in societies which are not essentially European or Western. There the reason is you try to impose a model which is not native, which doesn't suit their genius. You have to think of models that suit your genius. We had an excellent opportunity in 1947. In fact, this debate about what should be the way forward for independent India began just few years before 47. None other than Gandhiji had raised this question. In fact, you know, it's very interesting to hear that whenever anybody asks Gandhiji, sir, what's your vision for future of India, independent India, he would say Ram Rajya. Now, Ram Rajya, one can say it's a theocratic idea. No. Ram Rajya is the Indian model of democracy, where the view of the last man prevails. You hear about that story in Ramayana when Ram comes back after conquering Lanka and bringing Sita back to Ayodhya. Somebody in the audience, in his kingdom, a dhobi, says something about Sita. Then Ram decides that no, because it's a view of, even if one man has a view about Sita, I have to, as a king, I have to respect that view. Now, there can be a feminist argument on that. There can be a gender argument on that. But the very fact that the view of the last man prevailed is Ram Rajya. So we had our own concept of democracy. Gandhiji talked about Gram Rajya, Gram Swarajya. In fact, he was ridiculed. Even today, when we mention about Gram Rajya, Gram Swarajya, the so-called progressive world ridicules us. What do you mean? You want India to live in villages? What are these MDGs all about? It's about bettering the lives of largely the people living away from urban centers, largely. It also tackles the issues of urban centers. In India, the reality has been that majority population lived in villages. But when the issue came up just before the independence, one person who stood up and told Gandhiji that you are wrong was none other than Nehru. Nehru said, no, India should follow the European model. Remember, these were his words, European model, European way. So he said, socialism is the way forward. We had a dispute at that time. In fact, he tells Gandhiji, Gandhiji, you are talking about villages. And let me tell you, there is a letter in 1945, 5th September, 9th September, he writes to Gandhiji, in which he says, Gandhiji, look, you talk so much about the villages. I consider villages as centers of narrowness, backwardness, selfishness. If the country has to prosper, you need to have cities, and city culture has to flourish. Gandhiji's argument was different. Gandhiji said, see, India lives in villages. When I say village-centric development model, I'm not saying villages should remain backward. I'm saying you have a model that develops villages. He in fact says, I have a dream about Indian villages. I want my dream to be fulfilled. I want ideal villages today.
मैं कभी अमेरिका जाता हूं तो किसी प्रोफेसर से मिला, सर प्रोफेसर साहब कहा है सर वो जैक्सनविल में है। जैक्सनविल क्या है? ए स्मॉल कम्युनिटी अवे फ्रॉम द हसल एंड बसल ऑफ द सिटी, दे बिल्ट ए स्मॉल नेबरहुड, दे कॉल्ड इट जैक्सनविल, जैक्सन विलेज। यार यू हैव टू क्रिएट मॉडल गुड विलेजेस, यू हैव टू प्रोवाइड एम्प्लॉयमेंट एट द विलेज लेवल, बट फॉर सम रीजन नेहरू हैड अ डिफरेंट मॉडल, नेहरू हैड द यूरोपियन मॉडल इन माइंड। दीनदयाल जी, अनफॉर्चुनेटली गांधी डाइड इन 1948, इट केम ऑन द शोल्डर्स ऑफ पीपल लाइक दीनदयाल जी टू लुक एट द वे इंडिया वॉज प्रोग्रेसिंग अंडर द आइडिया ऑफ सोशलिस्ट सोसाइटी। इट्स अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग थिंग इफ यू स्टडी द फर्स्ट 14 15 ईयर्स ऑफ नेहरूवियन गवर्नमेंट इन इंडिया। आई एम सॉरी आई एम नॉट हियर टू यू नो अटैक नेहरू, बट इट्स इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर दिस होल डिस्कशन। नेहरू वॉज नेवर कंसिस्टेंट अबाउट हिज सोशलिज्म। प्लीज रीड, ही फर्स्ट यूज सोशलिज्म, ही देन सेड सोशलिस्ट पैटर्न ऑफ सोसाइटी। When somebody asked what is the difference between socialism and socialist pattern of society, on one occasion he says both are the same. On another occasion in the parliament, when questions were raised about the failure of socialism, he says, no, 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 you are not understanding. Socialism is different and socialist pattern of society is different. And very interestingly, in all his life, he never defined what he meant by either socialism or socialist pattern of society. We were enamored by certain ways and models of the West. We never tried our own model. What Deendayalji tried to tell us was, here is your own model based on three important principles. Two of them are covered under SDGs, but even third, even SDG doesn't cover. Those three are, one is dignity. Man wants dignity, friends. All your models, all your developmental models have to keep the dignity of man. When I say man, it includes woman. Dignity. Second is freedom. Man's ultimate urge is for freedom. By freedom, it is not just political. In fact, there's a very important statement that Gandhiji dictates to Mirabai on 27th January 1948, 3 days before his death. It's available on the internet. Please read it. In which he recommended the dissolution of Congress as a political party. The reason he gives is very interesting. He says, we have acquired independence, but it is only political freedom. He used the word political freedom. We have become politically free on 1947, August 15. But for people living in more than 5 lakh villages of India, social, economic, and moral, ethical freedom is yet to come. They are not socially free. Social evils about which MDGs talked a little bit. Economic backwardness. 17% was the literacy rate when we became independent. And moral degradation. He said, you need to address these issues, the status of women in this society, the status of scheduled castes in this society, Harijans in this society. This needs to be addressed. The solution he suggested was, so disband Congress as a political party and create Lok Sevak Sangh and address these issues, work for these three issues, then only I consider that India has really become independent and free. So freedom has this big spectrum. So man wants freedom. Man wants peace. The third is unity, friends. That cannot be addressed by MDGs and SDGs. It is a higher level idea. Unity, when I say, remember, it's not uniformity. There are forces in the world. In the name of a particular ideology, they want uniformity, same form. Communism tried it. Capitalist society tried it. But at the end of it, UNESCO, in 1981 document, accepts the point that world is so diverse, you cannot have any one model to suit the entire world. The models have to be different. You cannot think of uniformity, but you have to strive for unity. Unity, what Deendayal says, what Indian philosophy says essentially, unity with respect for diversity. India has the philosophy, that's what Swami Vivekananda tells at his Chicago speech in 1893 at the World Parliament of Religions. I come from a country where we just don't limit ourselves to tolerance. In fact, there was the whole talk about tolerating, tolerance. Tolerance of religions, he says, is an inferior idea. Because tolerance means what? You are a lowly fellow. You are bad. You are smelling badly. Yet, think I tolerate you? Tolerance has arrogance. Vivekananda says, I come from a philosophy which does not just tolerate, but accept the diversity. We validate different ideas and different philosophies. And he goes one step further and says, we are a society who just do not validate and accept. We celebrate diversity. Celebrating diversity. Vividhata ka utsav manana. But uske andar unity ka nirman karna. So that unity, freedom, and dignity, these are the three aspects that humankind requires. Integral humanism is an idea which addresses these three important aspects. The 16th SDG is about peace, friends. The most important aspect, probably the only aspect that comes under the third aspect of unity I talked about. The natural state of the universe, of the creation, is peace. War is not the natural state. It's another matter that the history that we teach to the mankind today is the history of wars, of the conflicts. Read European history, read the history of any country. The benchmarks that you find in history are about wars, are about victories, are about kingdoms. You have to talk about the history of communities, history of peoples. That is the way to bring peace in the world. Peace is the natural state of affairs. We in India, in our mythology, mythology is history for us. In that we read that in a sannyasi's ashram, there is a tiger, there is a cow, there is a man, there is a child, all of them living together. That is the natural state of the creation. Through our institutions, through our constitutions, through our laws, we have created conflict whereby each one fights against the other, each one tries to conquer the other, we try to conquer the nature tries to conquer us, then you have all the issues of climate change, etc., etc. Indian philosophy, which Deendayal highlights, is about the core natural idea of the creation called peace. That is why any Indian prayer begins and ends with only one phrase, Om Shantihi, Shantihi, Shantihi. Let there be universal peace in the world. Friends, this is the direction in which Deendayalji wanted the thinking of the world to turn to. Deendayalji did not give any model. Deendayalji only gave a philosophy. He did not create any ideology. He only created an idea. And this idea is not Deendayalji's idea, like Karl Marx's idea tha, Joseph Keynes' idea tha. Marx ka to ideology hi ban gaya wo. Deendayalji's idea is the idea of the quintessential Indian genius, which we have acquired, we have developed over millennia of its existence. I think on that idea we have to build institutions that suit the 21st century. I always tell the model has to be contemporary. We are the only people who believed that there will be eternal principles, but models have to change to suit the changing times. So I'm sure in the day-long proceedings today, lot of discussions will happen on these issues. I heartily thank the organizers, Atulji and Sachinji, for giving me this wonderful opportunity. Thank you and Namaskar.